At 16 and it's replay to be advised.
Well, thanks for joining us for today's Valley's People. It's almost an award day today because my two guests have awards from various parts of the community and richly deserved too. The first guest, in fact, is a Newcastle Rotary Citizen of the Year, plus a few other awards, including a Newcastle Star Newspaper Citizen of the Month. And the second guest is a lady who has an award, the Newton John University Award, for working on behalf of women in the Hunter Valley. I hope you can stay and meet these two people. Our first guest is 79 years of age, a character of the Hunter Valley, tall, 6 feet plus, a piper. In fact, he's everything. You could ask this man a question about anything and he's got an answer. James Webster, they call you Jim, welcome to the Valley's People. Now, I think everyone in the Hunter Valley, through television and public appearances, has seen you leading pipers, has seen you at Anzac Day services for 50 years or more.
Yep.
But how long have you been playing the pipes, bagpipes?
I'd say over 60 years. Over 60 years.
And with that accent, of course, you came from Scotland.
I come from Dundee, north of Scotland.
And you've got a military background, is that right?
I have. I've served with the British Army at the tail end of Number One War and moved up the occupational forces into Germany, in where I spent 10 months. One of my officers happened to be the Duke of Gloucester.
Oh, really?
Prince Henry, who frequently rode beside me.
Good heavens. Certainly, the family has a military background.
Yeah, it goes back several generations, in which it goes down by my generation, back to my great-grandson serving in Vietnam, while my own two boys flew over the top of me in Malaya.
Well, then what regiment were you in, Jim?
I was with the regiment 11th Hussars in the British Army, the 2nd 30th Battalion AIF.
11th Hussars, am I right in saying that goes back to the charge of the Light Brigade?
That is the regiment I actually took part in the Light Brigade charge.
But they were all mad, weren't they? I mean, with cavalry against cannons?
Well, it might have been an opinion, but they thought they were doing right. Apparently they were wrong.
I know all about that. I saw the Errol Flynn movie, you know?
Yes.
No, but they really, I mean, did you keep that tradition within the regiment, do you, that charge?
Oh, yes. Probably it was a wrong command given, and it was done without thinking. Not serious thinking, of course. What happened was a complete disaster.
Yes, but
yet it would carry part of great military history, the famous charge.
Again, though, you've got to remember it for courage, haven't you?
That's correct. That was what
or stupidity.
That was accepted, the fact that into the Valley of Death rode the 600.
Yes. Yes. Well, of course, into almost the Camp of Death rode Jim Webster and a lot of Allied troops during the war, because you were interned at Changi, weren't you?
That I was.
Prisoner of war camp in Singapore. Still as a piper?
No, I was serving the AIF. There's no registration of a piper in the Australian Army. I was just a corporal. But I had been playing pipes so long, and I made contact with the Gordon Highlands. Of course, they in turn invited me to keep and play with them.
And are these the pipes that you had there in the war?
No, my original set of pipes went missing in Malaya, but was later brought back and are now in Canberra War Museum, my original set. But when the Gordons found I had mine had gone missing, they presented me with this particular set, which is an army issue at the British Army.
But these are the pipes that you actually played in Changi for 3.5 years.
Yes.
And what does a piper do in a prisoner of war camp like that? How do you get to play them? Ceremonial days?
The Japanese didn't trouble us as far as instruments. We had quite good bands there, quite a good concert party, which had instruments, and pipes were used just at ceremonial parades, but mostly at funerals, unfortunately, because we had a considerable amount of funerals done per day, not per week, but per day.
I don't want to seem facetious, but you would have had a lot of piping with burials.
Quite a good considerable amount, yes. And as you know, bagpipes, you don't necessarily have a lot of wind to play it. The fact is it's controlled breathing, it just simply plays them. It's a matter of instrument playing, it's not a matter of wind at all. It's a wind instrument, but not necessarily a big blown instrument.
Yes, well, of course, the picture we have of Changi, of course, is ill-treatment and abuse of prisoners and so on. What was the food like? Were you able to survive to play the pipes?
The Japanese had a rather peculiar idea of life. They said if you were sick, you didn't have to eat, so there was no ration issue to anybody who was sick. And when you consider it, at least 60% of the force was under in sickness and malaria and dysentery and these sort of things. There were 60% of us not getting rations from the Japs. So the other 40% had to share their rations with the 60 that was not getting any.
Did you come out of that with bitterness and resentment to the Japanese nation?
Well, I'm afraid I wouldn't have to answer that truthfully. Because of the last loss in Japan, I'm afraid there wouldn't have been too many Japanese left. Probably we got more results from the officers who were more educated. The average Japanese soldier was rather severe because he was inclined to be a bit bitter. In fact, he thought he'd won a great victory, therefore he was the boss and he was dictating all the terms to us.
Mm. But a lot of the officers were educated in Western universities.
Yes, quite a considerable. In fact, quite a good deal of them. In fact, our company, our battalion commander there, was a very, very humane person.
Mm. Jim, could I ask you just something about the bagpipes now? Historians have suggested that a bagpipe is in fact a war instrument.
Well, it goes back in history that some people who didn't know the value of pipes as far as an instrument considered it a war instrument because it stirred the person up to get more courage and probably made a better job of him as a fighter.
I mean, humorists might disagree.
Yeah, well, it sort of stirred the blood up and made him a better fighter. And that instilled courage into them, probably, when they wouldn't have done otherwise.
There's something I'd like to know, because my father was in the Air Force and we talked about some of these things, and he always had the viewpoint that he would much rather march behind a pipe band than, shall we say, the glamour, loudness and music of a large military band. Now, is there any truth in that that we could explain?
Yes, well, the systematic beating of a pipe band is left and right foot stepping, in which the beat of the drum is on either foot, so you cannot lose time. Whereas with the brass instrument, there's something, a double beat in some of the music, which makes you sort of dog trot a little bit and then come back into tempo.
You've lost me a bit. What is
that?
What's a double beat?
Our set pace is 108 paces to the minute at a certain left and right foot, deliberately beating on the drum. So you cannot pick out a beat at all. You must keep in step with the drum. Where brass band in a symphonic music often strike two beats in the drum under one foot.
You mean a boom boom?
That's the idea, and that's for it. Makes you sort of step 2 foot. That's the only reason. And another thing, you can last a longer distance by marching at 108, which is the set pace of a bagpipe, against 120 that a military brass band plays. 120 takes more out of you than 108, and yet we do the same, get the same ground covered, because we take a 30-inch pace against a military step of 28-inch pace.
So you've got more courage because you're behind a pipe?
No, the fact that you go along, you more or less stroll, you don't march to a set tempo, a fast tempo. We walk to a slower tempo with a larger step.
But the piper, on those old recreations of the early battles against, say, England and Scotland, they're always going to war with the piper out in front, almost like the standard bearer, wasn't it?
Yeah, yes. Well, at first it was used as a sort of a call to the clans when they wanted to gather together a meeting. Instead of ringing a bell or sending a telegram, the piper stood up on the hill and played his bagpipe, and everybody said, hello, there's a meeting on somewhere.
That's right.
So they all gathered towards that piper, and the clans got together around the area. It was a sort of a call instrument used for a call, something like the Swiss pipe idea.
Yeah, well, I don't think, without equivocation, there's no better piper known in the Hunter Valley than James Webster. You're guard of honour for everybody and everything. Have you got a favourite one or two?
I've been honoured on several occasions in the area here. I had the honour of providing a guard of honour for Kingsford Smith when he flew the Pacific, and he had a civic reception at the Palais Hall here in Newcastle, and I was privileged to have a flight in the Southern Cross over Newcastle with him. And then later in the war, we had an incident of Doolittle, the man that first bombed Tokyo.
Yes.
He came here as a visiting personality, and in turn, he also had a guard of honour, and which I did provide that too. Then we had several occasions where the Americans came here celebrating the Coral Sea Battle, in which I did all the honours, military honours in that respect, and met several very big personalities in the, from the young, both Navy and military services.
Yeah, and you've given your experiences really to, I suppose, kids for, 40, 50 years in pipe bands.
Yes,
in Newcastle.
Yes, I've had the honour of playing. In fact, some of the best pipers in Newcastle area have come under me at some time or other.
Yeah, I can imagine that too, Jim, because you're a very forceful character.
I got the education under the Gordon Highlanders, which is very high class, which comes from the College of Music in Edinburgh, and that's the standard of music that I educate the boys. It's a very difficult instrument to master, not so much as the most of the people don't know the melodies in it because there's no lyrics. It's a marching music instrument, so therefore there's no songs or no words to it.
If you were in Changi during the war and you came from Newcastle, you could have known maybe the officer in charge of the prisoner of war camp.
Oh,
that
well
was
known.
Black Jack Galligan, wasn't it?
Oh, well known.
From Carrington.
He was originally born in Carrington, served overseas with the military forces in World War I, came back to Newcastle and was CO of the 2nd Battalion Newcastle before he was transferred to Sydney. Then he was joined the AIF. From there, he was a customs officer in Sydney and Newcastle for years, previous to going to Sydney.
And he was finally in charge of all the prisoners at the
camp? He was a senior officer. When they took Percival away, he was a senior officer in Changi, in complete command of the whole of the prisoner of war camp in Changi.
Mm. James Webster, I think that you're tall in many more ways than your height in the Hunter Valley, because you've given your life really for the people here, not just in the Scott tradition either, but I think you've become one of those people that came here with his family in years gone by, and you've really given your all.
I came here with 3 sons and a daughter, and 2 sons served in the RAAF with me. They were flying over me while I was in Changi prisoner of war camp. They were flying over the top of me.
I guess we can't convince everyone in this interview they should like the bagpipes. That's impossible.
Well, that's a matter of opinion. Of course, people doesn't know the music of bagpipe, but stirs the blood of other perspective, even if you are an Irishman.
Yes, I'd say that. James Webster, thank you very much. You've stirred the blood of a lot of people in the Hunter Valley for a number of years, and I hope that you could be blessed for a few more Anzac Day services yet.
Thank you.
James Webster, the best-known piper, undoubtedly, in the Hunter Valley. I'll be just back in a moment with our second guest. Welcome back to the Valleys, people. Our next guest is Mary Colcott, who has the Working Women's Centre and her committee at Mayfield and has been a champion for women in the Hunter Valley for a number of years. In fact, in 1974, she in fact came forward with the viewpoint that there were specific problems of people in the Hunter Valley, particularly women. I'm just wondering, Mary, if you could tell me what it was in 1974 that was in fact a specific and a problem.
Some of them still are problems for women. But there were services that weren't very well known. They weren't very easily accessible to women. Women weren't going along for help. They felt guilty about perhaps not being able to manage children as well as they thought they should, but felt they were responsible and were too guilty to seek help for it.
So there were none of those services at their fingertips, those special health services?
They were there, they weren't being used, they weren't available for working women because they weren't open at the times when most women, you know, are free to go.
Yeah. It was a 9-to-5 environment.
9-to-5.
Yes.
And we felt there was need for facilities after work and facilities where women could go before they had a major health problem. For instance, working women don't usually take time off from work unless they're sick. And then when they're sick, they go along for treatment of the particular sickness at the time. And if they have the flu, they don't really want a doctor to be examining breasts or doing a pap smear then. So working women weren't using the ordinary preventative services that were available.
Right. Although, and Mary, the award you won, the Newton John Award at the university for your work in the awareness, I guess, of the status of women is a terminology I could use. Now, from what to what is the status of women? I mean, where were you and where are they?
Yeah. Women have been moving very quickly in the last few years, and I think will continue to move because of new legislation. For instance, in this period, there's been anti-discrimination legislation, which gives women equal opportunity in employment, that women may not be discriminated against because they're women. In selection for appointments, in promotion during career, these things have been legislated about, and I think attitudes will change. They have been changing. That's one of the things that women's status has changed about. We're equal before the law in other matters. In family law, for example, Australia leads actually in the kind of fault-free divorce that we've got. Women have equal rights to the communal property if there's divorce. There are better things happening for women, and for men too actually, than there were 5 years ago in family law. And in women's health, women have more control over their fertility now than they did 5 or 10 years ago. There are more family planning services. Girls in school and boys in school learn that contraception exists and that people can control when they're going to have children. There are abortion services now that everyone knows about. There were some facilities 5 years ago, but women didn't know of them. So that now women can enter employment knowing that they can say they will work for 5 years at this particular job before having children. They even know with the new maternity leave legislation that they can return to that job.
When you attempt to lift the status of anything or anybody, it's almost an equation over time, isn't it? I mean, are things going along at the pace that you believe is acceptable? Or should
Things
we say, can the community adjust to the pace?
Fast enough for right. me. When we were given money to open our centre, we were told that 10 years would see the necessary changes. And sometimes we think there have been no changes, but attitudes have changed. In women's groups, they've changed. Well, for 10 years or more, it's been fashionable to have discussion groups of women sitting talking. They would introduce themselves as, I'm Mary Callcott, I'm married and I have 2 children, and then move on to the next person who would introduce herself in a similar way. Just struck me, not very long ago, we had very much the same looking group of women sitting down in the same sort of circle, and it started off as, my name's Mary, I'm a psychologist, I do this and that, and something else and something else, and the relationships were left way to the end. Sometimes they weren't even mentioned. Women are no longer introducing themselves to each other by being someone else's wife or someone else's mother or someone else's daughter. They're people.
Individualists. Hmm. I wonder, do I describe you as a feminist or a women's libber? How do I describe you? Or do you just Mary Callcott?
I don't mind. well, no one agrees on what a feminist is or what a women's libber is, so doesn't worry me.
Right. Yeah. Well, what the question I'd like to ask, Mary, because I think it's fascinating within the terms of, say, the Hunter Valley, how would you now view, shall we say, some of the pioneer women of the Hunter Valley who went out, lived in a wood hut without any modern amenities. They were childbearers from 17, some of them to 46 and 47 years of age. Mm. Were these people just underprivileged, unaware, crazy, or were they in fact individualists? Did they have anything
I've
going
got
for
a
them?
A lot of admiration for those women. And researchers now are writing about them and emphasising the achievements of those women, even calling it her story instead of his story.
Right.
There's women contributed, and many of them have been forgotten, that Carolyn Chisholm started a refuge for women, I don't know, 100 years ago or more. There've always been women doing outstanding things, and women have always been doing significant work. Yeah.
Yeah, but
just
see, immediately though, you jump to the significant example. I wasn't thinking of that. I was thinking of the no example, just a person locked up in that hut. Would you try to elevate her status given today's situation?
I don't think they had as happy a life as women can have now. I'm sure they didn't, and I've got no ambitions, and I don't think many women would like to return to live in the conditions that our sisters did 100 years ago.
Oh, no, those good old days of scrubbing boards.
No,
and
I would rather have a hospital there if I need it, and know that I will have the very best attention within an ambulance ride, and a pension in my old age, and all sorts of things that they didn't have then.
Well, the thing about the Working Women's Centre at Mayfield is really that it's an Australian first, isn't it?
It's still a first. Unfortunately, there hasn't been money for others to follow along. This is the only centre where so many services to help women and to promote the interests of women are all together in one place.
Mm. And what does it do?
Well, we do try to do just that. Because there is now a well-known place that's interested in women's affairs, that we're often asked to make some contribution to look at the new legislation, perhaps the new look at occupational health and safety, for instance, where if someone wants to know what do women think about this, they could ring, and if no one at work actually has an answer, we can quickly find someone who does.
So as well as a reference point, though, I guess it's a comforter too, isn't it?
Yes. It's a reminder that women are here, that women are wanting things, that women are saying these things all the time. I think when people drive past into the industries, they probably think, gee, I'll have to do something about having more apprentices, taking on more trainees. These things have happened. Women's status in employment has changed in the last few years too.
Yes, yes indeed. And the younger girls, women that come to you, what are their expectations now for marriage?
I think they expect a better life than women of my age. They look forward to better relationships with husbands than we had. Some people are alarmed at the number of divorces. We've got 100 divorces a day, if you count Saturdays and Sundays as well. But to me, that isn't necessarily a tragedy. It means that young people are expecting more from marriage. And if the relationship doesn't develop as they hoped it would, they're prepared to finish that.
Yeah, the tragedy would be living with someone you hate, I guess.
I think there's more pain in that than a divorce.
Right, well, now that you've studied working women and women for the number of years in which you've been involved in it, Mary, are we going to see as many or less golden wedding anniversaries?
I don't see why we shouldn't see as many, because women are going to live longer. Men might even live longer too. The golden weddings might be celebrations of a much happier life than some of them are now, really.
So the Prime Minister will still be writing telegrams in the years to come.
I suppose.
Yeah. Mary Colcott, thank you very much for the Working Women's Centre at Mayfield and your committee and the work that you're doing for women in the Hunter Valley. And I'll be back in just a moment in today's Valley's People. I've enjoyed talking with our two guests today. I hope you've enjoyed their company. Tall, 79-year-old, 50 Anzac Day processions long, Jim Webster, a man who's worked so hard for pipes and pipe bands and children and the whole community of the Hunter Valley. And also, in nonetheless an important category, Mary Callcott from the Working Women's Centre at Mayfield. I hope you can join us again for the next program of The Valley's People. Bye for now.